And for the first question of our exam, question number one. And the question states, contrast the operation of a signature-based intrusion detection system, or IDS, with a behavior-based IDS, highlighting their strengths and weaknesses. Is it A, signature-based IDS relies on predefined patterns, while behavior-based IDS analyzes deviations from normal activity? Is it B, behavior-based IDS focuses on known attack patterns, while signature-based IDS adapts to emerging threats? Is it C, signature-based IDS is proactive, while behavior-based IDS is a reactive to identified threats? Or is it D, both signature-based and behavior-based IDS operate identically, differing only in terminology? Choose one answer in our 5 seconds. And the correct answer is A, signature-based IDS relies on predefined patterns, while behavior-based IDS analyzes deviations from normal activity. Signature-based IDS uses predefined patterns to identify known threats, while behavior-based IDS analyzes deviations from normal patterns, adapting to emerging threats. And for the incorrect answers, option B, the roles are reversed, signature-based is known patterns. Option C, behavior-based IDS can be proactive by identifying abnormal patterns. And option D, they operate distinctly based on patterns and behaviors. And for the next question of our exam, question number two. And the question states, elaborate on the concept of threat intelligence and how it contributes to an organization's cybersecurity strategy. Is it A, threat intelligence focuses on internal vulnerabilities, providing insights for patch management? Is it B, threat intelligence encompasses external threats, offering insights into the tactics of potential attackers? Is it C, threat intelligence is limited to historical data, aiding organizations in post-incident analysis? Or is it D, threat intelligence is solely the responsibility of the security team, not involving other business units? Choose one answer in our 5 seconds. And the correct answer is B, threat intelligence encompasses external threats, offering insights into the tactics of a potential attacker. Threat intelligence involves gathering and analyzing information on potential external threats, providing insights into the tactics, techniques, and procedures of potential attackers. And for the incorrect answers, option A is more aligned with vulnerability management. Option C, threat intelligence is often real-time and forward-looking. And option D, effective threat intelligence involves collaboration across business units. And for the next question of our exam, question number three. And the question states, discuss the challenges associated with implementing effective change management processes in a large, geographical dispersed organization and propose strategies to address these challenges. Is it A, challenges include communication gaps and differing time zones, solutions involve centralized communication platforms and staggered implementation? Is it B, change management is simpler in large organizations requiring minimal adaptations, solutions involve standardized processes? Is it C, challenges mainly arise from resistance to challenge, solutions involve imposing changes without extensive communication? Or is it D, change management processes are universally straightforward requiring minimal adaptation for large organizations? Choose one answer in our 5 seconds. And the correct answer is A, challenges include communication gaps and differing time zones. Solutions involve centralized communication platforms and staggered implementation. In large, geographically dispersed organizations, challenges often include communication gaps and time zone differences. Solutions involve centralized communication platforms and staggered implementation to accommodate diverse locations. And for the incorrect answers, option B, oversimplification of the challenges and solutions. Option C is ignoring the complexity of communication in geographically dispersed organizations. And option D is oversimplification and lack of recognition for organizational diversity. And for the next question of our exam, question number four. And the question states, compare the security implications of using symmetric encryption with a short key versus asymmetric encryption with a long key, considering factors such as performance and key management. Is it A, symmetric key encryption with a short key offers better performance but weaker security? Asymmetric encryption with a long key provides stronger security but lower performance? Is it B, both symmetric and asymmetric encryption with long keys offer equivalent security and performance? Is it C, symmetric encryption with a short key is more suitable for secure communications, asymmetric encryption with a long key is ideal for data storage? Or is it D, symmetric encryption with a short key and asymmetric encryption with a long key have identical security implications? Choose one answer in our 5 seconds. And the correct answer is A. Symmetric encryption with a short key offers better performance but weaker security. Asymmetric encryption with a long key provides stronger security but lower performance. Short keys in symmetric encryption offer better performance but weaker security, while longer keys in asymmetric encryption provide stronger security at the cost of lower performance. And for the incorrect answers, option B is an oversimplification. They have different implications for security and performance. Option C, asymmetric encryption with a long key is ideal for data storage. It's over-specific and not comprehensive. And option D is ignoring the distinct security implications of short and long keys. And for the next question of our exam, question number 5. And the question states, analyze the evolving role of nation states in cyber warfare and their motivations considering the impact on global cybersecurity. Is it A, nation states primarily engage in cyber warfare for financial gain, leading to increased global cooperation? Is it B, nation states focus on cyber warfare to establish dominance in cyberspace, potentially leading to increased tensions? Is it C, the role of nation states in cyber warfare is negligible, with non-state actors being the primary threats? Or is it D, nation states exclusively engage in cyber warfare for defensive purposes, enhancing global cybersecurity? Choose one answer in our 5 seconds. And the correct answer is B. Nation states focus on cyber warfare to establish dominance in cyberspace, potentially leading to increased tensions. Nation states often engage in cyber warfare to establish dominance in cyberspace, which can lead to increased tensions amongst nations. And for the incorrect answers, option A is an oversimplification. Motivations are diverse. Option C is ignoring the significant role of nation states. And option D is an oversimplification. Defensive motivations are only one aspect. And for the next question of our exam, question number 6. And the question states, differentiate between a phishing attack and a spear phishing attack, elucidating the specific threat vectors employed in each. Is it A, phishing attacks use social engineering to target specific individuals? Spear phishing attacks are generic and target a broad audience. Is it B, phishing attacks cast a wide net to capture sensitive information? Spear phishing attacks target specific individuals with tailored content. Is it C, both phishing and spear phishing attacks are exclusively rely on malware distribution as their primary threat vector? Or is it D, phishing attacks focus on infiltrating networks while spear phishing attacks primarily target physical security? Choose one answer. You now have 5 seconds. And the correct answer is B. Phishing attacks cast a wide net to capture sensitive information. Spear phishing attacks target specific individuals with tailored content. Phishing attacks are broad and aim to capture sensitive information from a wide audience, while spear phishing attacks are targeted and involve tailored content for specific individuals. And for the incorrect answers, option A, the roles are reversed. Option B is an oversimplification. Threats vectors vary. And option D is an incorrect attribution of goals for each attack type. And for the next question of our exam, question number 7. And the question states, contrast the vulnerabilities associated with buffer overflow and SQL injection, emphasizing the potential impact on a system. Is it A, buffer overflow and SQL injection vulnerabilities both result in unauthorized access to sensitive data? Buffer overflow vulnerabilities primarily impact web applications, while SQL injections affect network protocols? Is it C, buffer overflow vulnerabilities involve excessive memory usage, while SQL injection allows unauthorized database queries? Or is it D, both buffer flow and SQL injection vulnerabilities exclusively impact server-side applications? Choose one answer in our 5 seconds. And And the correct answer is C. Buffer overflow vulnerabilities involve excessive memory usage, while SQL injection allows unauthorized database queries. Buffer overflow vulnerabilities involve overwriting memory, whilst SQL injection allows attackers to execute unauthorized queries on a database. And for the incorrect answers, option A is an oversimplification. Impacts vary. Option B, it's an incorrect attribution of impacts. And option D, it's over-specific and incorrect. And for the next question of our exam, question number 8. And the question states, in a hypothetical scenario involving a malware infection, identify potential indicators of compromise, or IOCs, that could be analyzed to assess the extent of the threat. Is it A, unusually high network traffic and system resource usage are common indicators of compromise? Is it B, normal user activity and regular network traffic patterns are reliable indicators of compromise? Is it C, an up-to-date antivirus software status indicates a compromised system? Or is it D, frequent system updates and patch installations are indicative of malicious activity? Choose one answer in our 5 seconds. And the correct answer is A. Unusual high network traffic and system resource usage are common indicators of compromise. Unusually high network traffic and system resource usage are often indicative of a malware infection or other malicious activity. And for the incorrect answers, option B is contradictory. Compromised systems often exhibit abnormal patterns. Option C, an up-to-date status is a positive sign instead of a negative one. And option D, it's incorrect. Regular updates are a security best practice. And for the next question of our exam, question number 9. And the question states, detail the purpose of intrusion prevention systems, or IPS, in a comprehensive cybersecurity strategy, including their role in mitigating threats. Is it A, IPS focuses solely on threat detection, providing alerts without taking preventative actions? Is it B, IPS primarily addresses physical security concerns, deterring unauthorized access? Is it C, IPS is designed to identify and block potential threats in real time to prevent security breaches? Or is it D, IPS is a passive system that observes network traffic without taking any active measures? Choose one answer in our 5 seconds. And the correct answer is C. IPS is designed to identify and block potential threats in real time to prevent security breaches. Intrusion prevention systems, or IPS, actively identify and block potential threats in real time, playing a crucial role in preventing security breaches. And for the incorrect answers, option A, an IPS actively prevents identified threats. Option B, IPS is focused on network security. And option D, IPS actively blocks threats based on predefined rules. And for the last question of our exam, question number 10. But before that, if you enjoyed this content, make sure to drop a sub and share it with your friends. And now back to our question. Compare the security implications of a monolithic architecture with a microservices architecture, highlighting their strengths and weaknesses. Is it A, monolithic architecture is more secure due to its simplicity, whilst microservices introduce complexity and vulnerabilities? Is it B, microservices architecture enhances security through decentralized components, while monolithic architecture relies on a single point of failure? Is it C, both monolithic and microservices architectures have identical security implications, differing only in design philosophy? Or is it D, monolithic architecture is suitable only for small-scale applications, while microservices are inherently more secure for larger systems? Choose one answer in our 5 seconds. And the correct answer is B. Microservices architecture enhances security through decentralized components, whilst monolithic architecture relies on a single point of failure. Microservices architecture, whilst its decentralized components, can enhance security by reducing the impact of a single point of failure compared to monolithic architecture. And for the incorrect answers, option A is an oversimplification. Both have unique security considerations. Option C is incorrect. Their security implications vary. And option D is incorrect. Suitability and security are separate considerations. Ladies and gents, this is the end of our exam. If and only if you found this video useful, make sure to drop a sub and share it with your friends. I hope you found this video informative, and I'll see you guys next time.